Eyre's on the Road, value-based parenting and life balance ideas from world-traveling family coaches. Here's Richard and Linda Eyre.
Hello, and welcome back to Eyre's on the Road. We're so happy you're here.
That's becoming our thing we say every time. Linda, I just look at you and you say, hello, and welcome to Eyre's on the Road. Very nice.
We hope that you had a great week. As we record this, actually, it's Good Friday, and we have had a very good week. We had a Seder dinner last night, just a very abbreviated one, just so that we could be a little better educated with our daughter and her family, and it was really beautiful.
It really was. These, you know, religious traditions of all faiths are pretty special because they bring people together. They bring families together. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. I mean, you could say, well, you guys always talk about families, but our three-letter lesson, the 10th one in this series, is going to be related to that. But before we quite get to it, honey, Eyre's on the road. We are kind of on the road. We're heading out tomorrow for Mallorca. Wonder how many people just know instantly where Mallorca is.
I didn't.
It has kind of a ring to it. It's a lovely little island. Island. It's actually the biggest island in the Mediterranean, but it's small enough that you can drive around it in 6 hours.
Just off the coast of Spain. And it's going to be very interesting. We're going to be there for a week. Our son is joining us from Zurich toward the end of the week.
That's really where we're going. We're going to visit our son who lives in Milans, which is not Milan.
Milans.
But Milans, a small town in the very south of Switzerland, right close to Italy, in the Alps.
The Alps, yeah.
Right by Davos, which a lot of people have heard of. But on the way, we found an interesting opportunity to stop off on Mallorca for a week on our way to Switzerland. So we'll be broadcasting, or we'll be doing our next podcast from Mallorca. We'll tell you a little more about it. It's a place we've never been. It's getting a little hard to find places we haven't been.
Oh, no.
That's not true.
That's not true. There's so many places.
In fact, our big debate is I always want to go back to places we have been. And Linda's like, but if we do, well, there will be a place we won't get to.
That's right. I always like to go someplace new. Restaurants, too, but you're winning on that.
Oh, going back to old restaurants, yeah. Standbys.
Right. Anyway, we're so happy that you're with us. We are going to be talking about family today.
Kind of a unique way, maybe.
In introduction, I have to say that one of our daughters got on Marco Polo, and our kids are spread all over the world, so we really have to do Marco Polo. But she got on Marco Polo yesterday and said, this is ridiculous. You guys, we have this opportunity to have a little update from everybody on this thing, and it's not hard, and you can do it your own time, and you can listen to it your own time. And this is an update on our family. And she told us stuff that was happening that we had no idea. And then people chipped in. They're starting to come. It's so fun. We have a little 8-year-old grandson that said, grandfather, did you realize that your hair was standing straight up?
On your last post?
On your last post. But it really is so fun to be in touch with family, because we are at a point where it is really hard to stay in touch with the comings and goings of that many people.
And yet it shouldn't be, because it is so easy with Marco Polo or with just texts or
FaceTime.
FaceTime or other
Zoom.
We're just so lucky.
There's so many ways
we can be
to stay
in such
touch.
Close touch. And we got to quit assuming things. We got to quit saying, well, they're fine and they're fine. And we know kind of what they're doing. I don't know. Do you think people need a schedule? Do we need a schedule? We've been trying to do a Zoom call with all of our children on together, all of our families, once every fortnight, every 2 weeks, in other words. And that's a good catch up, although,
and you know, everybody can't
do it all
at
once.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. That's why Marco Polo is so good, or other social media where you can leave, you know, a video message and really give an update. And we got to quit assuming that everyone kind of knows what we're doing and say, well, let's get a little detail here. Here's what we're thinking, not only what we're doing, what we're thinking, what we're feeling. That's so important. And it is, you know, a lot of families live close together and still don't communicate as much as they should. I'm not sure.
Maybe next door is the hardest.
Yeah.
You know, you just see the coming and going, and probably a lot of you are more involved because you do have children closer and you're still running carpools or whatever it is, but it really is so important to stay in touch with family.
And don't you think that some social media actually works against really being up to speed on people? Because Twitter, you're saying some little teeny thing, or a lot of times Instagram is just a picture, and that's not real communication.
No, but it's better than nothing.
It's better than nothing. I mean, it sort of shows
a lot better
there, but the idea of getting a little deeper and you know, a lot of families used to write a letter each week and everyone would contribute. This is going back, years and years. But do the same thing with a Marco Polo or another thing. I'm eating an apple trying to keep from coughing. I've got a little cough today. I'm going to bring my little cough to Mallorca maybe.
Yeah. It's not COVID, but wow, we're not out of the woods yet on that.
But speaking of on the road again, we do have, we often blame ourselves. We traveled so much with our children when they were little, partly because we were going on book tours and we were going on speaking trips and we had a lot of mileage. We had a lot of miles to take kids with us on things. And maybe that's the reason they travel so much. But yesterday, one of our daughters, our oldest daughter, Saren, just returned from a trip with her husband and their two twins to Morocco.
It was their big senior trip. And I have to give you a little bit of background. Last year, they were all ready to do this, had all the hotels, all the plane connections, camel rides, everything. On the way to the airport, one of the twins tested positive for COVID. And we may have mentioned that when it happened. But anyway, this poor daughter has been working for almost a year now to reorganize this trip. And because these kids are going to be seniors next year, they usually take them when they're 16 for a nice trip.
But what a trip it was. I mean, you know, speaking of places we haven't been, our kids kind of pride themselves in going, well, that's not the right thing, but it is interesting when they go somewhere we haven't been. And Morocco, I mean, it just, think of the names of the cities they visited in Morocco, and you can't help but be intrigued. Marrakesh, Casablanca, Tangier, Rabat, Fez, my favorite, Fez. Who named those cities? They're talk about faraway places with strange sounding names.
Well, they probably think our Chicago sounds funny to them too.
Remember that song, faraway places with strange sounding names.
Anyway, they've had a wonderful time.
But then one of our other daughters, Sadie, just got back with her family from Guatemala, where they've been doing some humanitarian work. And I mean, not Guatemala City, but up in the mountains where her husband, Jeff, served his mission many, many years ago. And boy, did they have a time.
They had an amazing time because he served up in the mountains with lots of village people. I mean, not lots, even.
Lots of really tiny people.
Tiny people. who
wonderful were people
speaking Quechi, which was not even Spanish. It's a totally different language. So he knew some Spanish when he went, but then he had to learn Quechi, and then he taught Spanish to his companion, which has been very helpful to him as he's had his family and had his work life. So they had an amazing experience.
The other thing we want to mention in kind of a preliminary, although usually half of ours on the road is preliminaries while we're getting around to the subject.
Yeah, we're going to get to it,
But we did want to mention grandparenting again because we are so grateful and excited that there is so much interest. We're starting a grandparenting course called Grandparenting 101, the basics, but it's really going to go beyond the basics because we've just been flooded. We just put out on this show and on some of our social media that this course is going on. We've got over 1,000 now people that want to sign up for this course.
And by going on, you mean going on in the future. It's not going on
right
now.
Yeah, that's gonna get started. We're developing it based on the question. We've done a little survey we've sent out, and what do you mostly want to learn about being a better grandparent? And my goodness, it's like a dam has burst. There's so much interest. And you know, if you're out there and you're a grandparent and you want to be involved, the way you get on this mailing list, this invitation list, is really simple. Just send an email to, I'll say this once and then I'll wait a minute and say it again. So if you need to get a pencil, but we want you to be involved if you're a grandparent or if you're about to become a grandparent. Just write if you have grandparents that you want to get them involved. Eyre's Grandparenting101@gmail.com.
And be sure you spell it E-Y-R-E-S.
Right. Eyre's, like it's plural, but without the apostrophe. So Eyre's Grandparenting101@gmail.com.
So
and
going
we'll get
on.
You on the list.
Yes, going on. But that's all about family too. We're really all about family. And it is so interesting to see how it changes as life goes on. But the word this week, the three-letter word,
give me a drum roll. You know, the three-letter lesson. And again, quick introduction. You guys know that every chance we have an open Eyre's on the road, we pick a three-letter word or abbreviation that has a lot of meaning that you can build a whole concept around, a whole conceptual framework. And this is number 10. We've done 9 up until now, honey. This is number 10, and the word is FAM, F-A-M. And that's not an official abbreviation, but it means a lot to us, those three letters, because we always, that's how we communicate. We say, how's the FAM? How's the FAM? Almost every letter I write, even in a business sense, I say at the end, hope you and the FAM are doing well. And I don't know why, it's just something we've done forever, but think of FAM, F-A-M, as a three-letter lesson about priorities, because everything eventually, listen, we're telling you as old people, we are looking back over our life and looking forward to a lot more life, but we're telling you if there's one thing we know, it all comes down to family in the end. And everyone has a family. One of the things that really worries us is people say, I don't have a family yet, or I don't have a family or whatever, meaning that they're not married or they don't have children. But that's just one little part of a family. We're all part of families. We all have parents. We all have, in most cases, at least one sibling. We have cousins, we have aunts, we have uncles, we have nephews, we have nieces.
And in a lot of cases, you have more than one family. If you're married, you have an in-law family. You know, there's so many things that point to family in our lives.
And that's what ultimately matters. We get so caught up in all these things we think matter. And they do to some extent, our profession or our interests, our hobbies, are the things that fulfill us, our travel, all these other things. But when it all settles out, it comes back to family.
And we have to say that some families are harder than others.
Absolutely.
We have been talking to friends this week who've struggling with their families. And I know that when there are times when we are struggling, it can be really hard things, relationship things, but it could be health things we're dealing with. Hearing loss of a grandchild this week. There's always family issues
that
you need to think about.
And in case you think, oh boy, here's the Eyre's again on family. Same old, same old. We're going to give you some different paradigms and suggest some different ways to look at your family and a bigger way to think of family than what we usually do. So stay with us and we'll take a little break and we'll come right back and get into the three-letter lesson of FAM.
Welcome back to Eyre's on the Road. Here's Richard and Linda Eyre.
And we're back. I'm talking about FAM today, a three-letter lesson. So take it, honey.
Well, you know, it's very, we were at a meeting the other day. We are part of a little group. In fact, it was something we initiated that has really blossomed, and we can't tell you too much about it because it's still in the works, as they say, but it's a meeting with the governor of, or it's a project with the governor of Utah. And this is no secret. In his State of the State address, Governor Spencer Cox said, you know, we are going to create a new office or a new department of government, and it's going to be the office of the Department of Children and Parents. In other words, the office of family, not to interfere in families. The last thing we need is government interfering in families, but to be a watchdog for families, to look out for the things that matter most, and to try to facilitate and support families. And the reason for that, the justification for it, of course, is the thing we always say. We give lip service to this. We say, oh, the family is the basic unit of society, right?
Right.
And that's true. I mean, it is the smallest organ. It is the basic unit. But what we forget is that it's even more than that. It's the basic unit of our economy. It's the base unit of our society, of our culture. It is the thing that everything else revolves around. And it is also the simplest and least expensive place to solve problems, right? I mean, that's why it's smart to have this new office or department, because if you can solve or prevent a problem in the basic unit of family, it never becomes part of the criminal justice problem or the welfare system problem or all the other things that government do. One way to think of government is a larger organization, either on a city or a state or a county or whatever level, that tries to deal with the problems when they escape out of the home. In other words, if we could solve every problem in the home, we would need much, much, much less government, right?
Right. And the government already does do a lot for families, and we're learning a lot about the defense, taking care of welfare families and taking right. care of, you know, really bad situations that they can't seem to get themselves out of.
But protecting children who need it.
Protecting those children. But we are thinking that we need to do more on the offense and really do some creative, wonderful things for families to help them realize how important they are to not only each other, but to society.
Yeah, exactly. And to change things that governments are doing that are impacting families negatively. I went to get my hair cut the other day, and my barber, it was so interesting because it was right before the reason I was getting my hair cut is we were going to this meeting with the governor and with the governor's people on this issue. And I thought I ought to get a haircut. And I'm sitting there in the barber's chair, and this barber starts going on the fact that I was asking about his family. How's your fam? Speaking of. And he said, well, you know, we're kind of discouraged because we're trying to buy a house. We want to have a little, we've got three kids. We want to have a home of our own. And we're trying to save our money. And we can't. I said, well, why can't you save your money? And he said, well, because we need food stamps right now. We're just not doing too well. And we need to feed our kids and we need to be on food stamps. But if we have more than $2,000 in savings, guess what? We can't get food stamps. And I said, wow. When government unwittingly makes it harder for families. And we all know that, you know, there's tax structures now in place in this country where you actually pay more tax if you're a family than if you're singles.
Right. There are so many ramifications. There are so many things that government is being well-meaning in trying to help people, but wow, I mean, you got to tell the end of the story because he had these beautiful shoes on, right?
Oh my gosh, really, I like this. He had a pair of $500 shoes on, and this barber, and he said, "Look at my shoes." He said, "I'm thinking of things to spend any money we do have, so I don't have too much savings, so we can still get food stamps." What a convoluted mess! Well,
that is really, it's a little bit weird, but anyway,
that is a little weird.
They could buy a lot of food with $500 for those shoes, but anyway, there are a lot of families that are just in need of real help and understanding of what they're doing and who they are and how important they are to the culture and to the government.
Yeah. You know, Linda, there's this weird, and it's kind of weird when you think about it, this saying that it's a cliche. People use it a lot, right? Blood is thicker than water. I mean, what does that really mean? At first, I've always thought this kind of an odd thing to say, but we know what it means, right? That what it means is what we're talking about here now, that ultimately your family is what matters. I mean, other friends will come and go. Various things in your life will come and go. Family will always be family. And to recognize that, and I mean, I'm thinking of a simple little example. We were with one of our grandkids the other day, and we're talking about his cousins and how cousins are more important than friends, because blood is thicker than water, because you're connected in a way that we believe is an eternal way. I mean, that's a whole nother dimension, right? I mean,
right.
A lot of us in our faith have a sign on our refrigerator or whatever that says families are forever. And so we kind of double down. We say not only is family the most important relationship you can have within a family, or the most important relationships on this world, but we believe beyond, and our marriages are not till death do you part, but for time and all eternity. And there's even a book written by one of the early prophets in our church that's called The Government of God. And the government of God is family. We believe the organization of God's children in the eternities is going to be a familial organization, a family organization. And there'll be a lot of welding going on, new people put into families and so on. But we don't understand the details. But we just know that family is the basic unit, not only of society and of culture and of the economy, but of eternity.
So we hope this is making you think about your own family and how well connected you are. You may be absolutely doing a great job, and many of you are, we know. But we can always do better. Life gets so busy. And when when Shani called, not called, but got on to Marco Polo and said, "Come on, you guys, I don't know what's going on in New York City. I don't know what's going on the mountains.
My brother's
in the
family,
Alps.
My sister's family.
Just let us know. Just take a minute." I think that there's just more we can do because everybody is so busy, to just keep pulling back to the center a little bit and making sure that we're in touch with family members, and especially with ones that we've had a little bit of trouble with.
Yeah. Mending fences, you know, not letting things go on and on. It is shocking how often we'll be giving a speech or we'll be traveling somewhere and someone will, for whatever reason, because they've read a book or something we've done, they'll share something with us. And it's shocking how often it is, "Oh, I'm estranged." Think what a sad word that is. I'm estranged from
my brother. Right now.
I haven't talked to my brother for 20 years. We just don't get along. We've gone our separate ways. We've got to mend those fences. We've got to find a way, because that person will always be your brother. That person will always be your cousin. And it's so easy to get offended. That's the thing. I mean, people in your family can hurt you or offend you in ways no one else can, because you care. I mean, something deep within you connects you to them. And so when there's a falling out, it hurts. And we just want to run away from it.
Right. In fact, Our prophet in a recent general conference, many of you will know what I'm going to say, really challenged us to find those people that, and not necessarily just family, but to mend, to mend some fences.
Yeah.
And to really think about what you can do to have a better relationship with somebody in your family or somebody who needs to be reconnected with. And I do think that is a really important challenge. We've both thought of somebody that was not necessarily a bad relationship, but could be better.
Yeah. And that reminds me, honey, one of the things that came out in this meeting with the governor's initiative on families was, wouldn't it be great if someone was looking out for families to the extent that every bill that goes to the legislature or every decision that's made by the judicial arm of government has some kind of a family impact statement. In other words, someone's sitting saying, how will this law or this case or this decision, how will it affect families? So we don't get into situations like the example of my barber the other day. And we can do that on a personal level. You know, one thing that has always made a lot of sense to the two of us and to our children and many people we know and work with is think of your life as sort of having two parts, the inner and the outer. The inner being what happens in your home, in your family, in your relationships with those you are related to. And then the other part being the outer, that everything that happens outside your home, your job, your hobbies, your interests, your investments, your leisure, all those things, and balance the two. Because if we're not careful, we end up spending 95% of our time on the outer stuff and nothing on the inner. And the inner, I like to think of it like a target or a bullseye. The bullseye is the family. That's the part that matters most. And it's the things out around it, the career, the interests, the even the church activity, what you do, those things are all there to support that family. In fact, it's one of our favorite quotes, a prophet in our church years and years ago said, the church is the scaffolding with which we build eternal families. Isn't that so? I just never tire in thinking about that. Even the church, something as important as the church, and people of faith don't want to put anything ahead of the church. The church is so magnificently important. But in this quote, it is important because it is the scaffolding, which implies it's temporary to some degree. It's the scaffolding with which we build eternal families. It's the family that lasts forever beyond this earth, not the church.
Right. What we're asking you to do and maybe challenging you to think about a little bit today, I think, is we're all in kind of a box, you know, with our family.
Yeah.
And just like this guy who is just has to have food stamps. He doesn't have to have food stamps. He can go out and do other things and so on. But we think we have to have a certain thing and have our family be a certain way to be successful or whatever the box is that you're in. And or we want our child to be different because it would be better for them and so on. And I think it's just so important to lift yourself out and family and say, what can I do to make our family better?
That's really well said, honey. And to close, maybe I can put that even in a graphic challenge. Take a piece of paper out. If you want to do something really interesting, take out a blank piece of paper and write a circle in the middle of it, a big circle, and write inside of their family. And then around it, so you've got the inner and the outer, what's in that circle and what's outside. And write down, just take a minute, let yourself think about all the dimensions of your family, not just your own children or your own parents or your own, but write in the names of your cousins and your uncles and everyone who's in your extended family. Think about that for a while as the bullseye. And then look at all the space around that circle and think a little about how your other things that you're doing in your life can be tied in to that family and how the family can be the ultimate goal and the thing that everything else has to support.
Well, It may sound like pie in the sky, but that's what we're about today. So we hope that we've given you some things to think about. Thank you for joining us, and we hope that we'll see you again next time on Eyre on the Road.
Bye for now.